Hey guys, welcome to Motoroids. My name is Amit and this is the Duke 125, a surprise package that KTM has delivered by the end of the year. And if you really look at it, there is hardly anything that differentiates it from the KTM Duke 200, which is a much bigger, more expensive motorcycle, save for a few changes, which I'm going to tell you all about. And the biggest change that obviously you can see is that Duke 125 stickering on the tank shrouds. And apart from that, if you really look for any other changes, I don't really think that you would be able to see any differences. These stickers, the design of it has been changed. But apart from that, this motorcycle is exactly the same as the Duke 200. And that includes the chassis, that 43mm inverted fork up front, the wheels, the tire size, everything is exactly the same. The colors that you get on this motorcycle are this black, you have an orange and a white. And all the goodies that you get on the Duke 200 are here, as I mentioned. Let me just run you through all the things that this motorcycle has. So up front you have this very little fly screen, and you have this halogen bulb with this pilot bulb here. You have this 10-step adjustable rear monoshock, and the trellis frame is there. This swing arm, beautifully crafted swing arm, is there. Everything has been taken as it is from the 200 Duke. You also have ABS, which comes as standard on this motorcycle. So you have a 300mm disc up front with ABS. And a very interesting thing about this ABS system on this motorcycle is that when you look at the rear disc brake, you'll see that there is that sensor ring there as well. However, don't be fooled, because this ring does gather data and it does send it to the ECU. However, this rear disc is not ABS, so this is a single channel ABS, this is not a dual channel ABS. And the other important thing that you need to know is that this is not switchable, it will always be on. KTM is also claiming that the ring at the rear aids RLP, that's rear liftoff protection, and the bike's rear would not lift off inadvertently if you apply the front brakes too hard. Now, this is a rebored version of the 200cc block that is there on the Duke 200. So if you look at the engine from the side, you would not be able to tell anything. It looks exactly like the 200cc engine. So an interesting fact about this motorcycle is that if you remove the stickers, it is the Duke. And if someone is looking at it from a distance, it would be the Duke. So if you want to buy a motorcycle purely from an image perspective, only for the looks of it, just remove those stickers and hardly anyone would ever be able to tell that this is not a Duke 200. Anyway, I was talking about the engine, and this engine is a rebored version of the 200cc unit. And I tested it, and it somehow feels a lot more tractable. It feels more usable, has a good amount of low-end torque as well. It's not as crazy after 6,000-7,000 RPM as the 200. Although the real power really comes in after that RPM only, but it does knock below 2,000 RPM, smoothens out slightly. After 4,000 RPM, it starts responding very nicely to the throttle inputs, but it really comes into its element only after 6,000-7,000 RPM. The peak power output here is 14.5 PS at 9,250 RPM. Peak torque is 12 Newton meters. If you really rev it hard, you'll realize that the red line is 9,500 RPM, and the engine actually goes all the way to 10,000 RPM, where the limiter cuts in. In gear speeds, first gear will take you to 40 kilometers per hour. Second gear will take you to 55 kilometers per hour. Third gear is going to take you to 75 kilometers per hour. Fourth gear will take you to 92 kilometers per hour. And to hit the 100, you'll have to hit the fifth gear, which will take you to 110 kilometers per hour. And the sixth gear is more like an overdrive, which is not going to increase your top speed. So the top speed of this motorcycle is 110 kilometers per hour. If you move to the sixth gear, it's essentially meant for better fuel efficiency and not for enhanced speed. So I have also done a 0 to 60, 0 to 100 top speed run. So you'll see that in a bit. However, since you have to move into the fifth gear, the 100 really takes a little bit of time before it comes in. Now, I'm quite sure that you want to know how smooth the engine is. And the good news is that the engine is very, very smooth. It's very torquey at the bottom end and it's very smooth also. So, very conducive for commuting. And even at 9,500 RPM, there are no mentionable vibrations. There are very, very mild vibrations at the footpegs and the handlebar, but totally ignorable. And I think that this is a pretty smooth engine and not worth complaining at all. The tires on the Duke 125 are also the same as the Duke 200, and it is equipped with MRF revs, 150 section rear and 110 section front, which provides it more than sufficient grip. Also, I'm sure that you want to listen to the exhaust, and let me just fire it up and let you hear the exhaust note as well. Seat height here is 810 mm, and which is on the taller side. I am 5'10 and I'm barely able to plant my heels into the tarmac, so that means that if you are shorter than 5'6, you would probably have a bit of a problem sitting on this motorcycle and maneuvering it. So it's not very suitable for very short riders. You can have a look at the seating stance here. This is how it is, exactly like the Duke 200 again. The pillion seat is even taller, so if you're a short rider, it would be difficult for you to swing a leg over it. And since you have these bars here, it's pretty comfortable to hold on to the bars, but sitting on the pillion seat is not the easiest. Lighting is LED at the rear, on the blinkers, on the front blinkers, but as I mentioned, the front headlamps are halogens. The other thing that I noticed is that this suspension right now is set to the third softest setting. This is a 10-step adjustable suspension, and although we are riding on the racetrack, there are some rough areas around it, and I deliberately took the motorcycle onto those rough areas, and the suspension seems perfectly usable for city. So if you are concerned about the stiffness of the suspension, that's not something to be worried about. This seems to be a very usable suspension for the city and would be able to take bad roads in its stride pretty well. Another important thing that a lot of motorcycles in this segment don't have is a very usable instrument console, and the instrument console here has also been taken from the Duke 200, so it gives you a lot of usable information, which includes average speed, but more importantly average fuel efficiency and distance to dry, etc. So this is important information, and by virtue of this information I was able to figure out the fuel efficiency of this motorcycle also. So the worst that I managed to see was about 20 to 22 kilometers per liter when we were really ripping it, and the best that I saw was about 50 kilometers to the liter. I can safely say that you'd be able to get about 40, 45 kilometers to the liter without any problem, and that's a very good fuel efficiency for a motorcycle that has this kind of power. So I really think that the fuel efficiency should not be a problem on this one. Now, coming to the price, is the price of 1,18,000 rupees ex-showroom really worth for a 125cc motorcycle? Well, to start off, this shares all the componentry with the Duke 200, so they have not shed the cost. You have inverted forks, you have the same chassis, you have everything the same. The engine is also the same, it's just a reboot unit, so you know, there is not much that KTM could have done to reduce the price much. It's a fantastically built package, and for that engine's power, I really think that the handling, those wide tires, the suspension really provide it a very solid platform. So it's a very sorted package overall. If you really look at the handling, the suspension and all the other mechanical bits, it's a very, very strong package. In fact, it really feels too much for an engine which is producing only 14.5 PS of power. I tried to really rip it very hard, but at every corner I really thought that this whole setup is just too much for this much of power. So in terms of the sure-footedness of this motorcycle, this has to be the best 125cc motorcycle that you can buy, be it braking, be it handling, be it the grip. I mean, in terms of handling, you cannot buy a better 125cc motorcycle for this price. Is this value for money? Well, if you really want to look at it from a pound-to-pound perspective, maybe not. It's not a value for money product per se, but if you really care about the image, if you really want to look good while you're riding a motorcycle, this is a premium brand, and I really think that KTM have not cut corners. They have provided a proper motorcycle with all the gear that the more expensive motorcycle has. So in that sense, I really think that this is good value for money if you really understand where I'm coming from. If you really care about the image, about the brand, I think this 125cc motorcycle for the youngsters who want to be using it for going to the college, for their everyday commute, I think it provides a very nice looking package, and which is very safe and very solid and is built to last. So that's that, guys. I really hope that I was able to answer most of your questions about this motorcycle. If you have any further questions, please put them in the comment section and I'll try to answer them as quickly as possible. And if you like the video, hit the like button, subscribe to Motoroids, hit that bell icon, follow us on Instagram, we are there as Motoroids_India, follow us on Facebook, and I'll keep coming up with more such videos. Until next time then, this is Amit Changani signing off. Rev hard, rev free, and ride safe.